PID controllers are known for 100 years, but even today a lot of engineers resort to the hit and trial method of PID tuning. After watching this video, I hope that you will be well equipped to understand your PID control and tune it properly. Let us check out the art of PID tuning, the science of PID tuning, and the automatic tuning methods. Before that, let us have a quick look at what is a proportional integral derivative controller. This is the closed loop system that we have seen in the previous videos, and this is where we will use the PID controller. Mathematically, we will multiply the error by Kp, integrate the error, and also take its derivative. Add all these three, and this gives us the controller output. But let us understand these terms qualitatively, and this is the art of PID tuning. We will use the same example as earlier. You want to maintain your speed of the car at 60. The idea of any control system is to know what actuating input gives us the desired output. And in our case, the PID controller will decide the actuating input. In this case, the reference is 60. We measure the speed using the speedometer and measure the error. This error is given to the PID controller. When we start, the speed is 0 and the error is 60. And let us say that we keep a gain of 0.01. This gives us the output to be 0.6, and this is the proportional controller. 0.6 can correspond to how much percent the pedal is pressed, where 1 means that the pedal is 100% pressed. As the error keeps reducing, the output of the controller will reduce. So, you can already see that this controller is not going to give you zero error. Because if the speed reaches 60 and the error goes to 0, then the output of the controller will be 0. That means you have stopped pressing on the pedal and the car will start slowing down. Moreover, with the proportional control, you would reach a steady state so that the output of the controller is sufficient enough to counter the drag and friction force. That is, the engine force will be equal to the drag force. So, how do we reduce the error? We add an integral component to it. The integral component understands that the error is still positive, and hence it will keep integrating and adding to the output of the controller. This will push the car forward until it reaches the steady state error of 0. At this point, the proportional output is 0 as the error is 0. And the integral output is some constant, whatever it integrated over time. And that will help the car maintain a desired constant speed. So, all looks good over here, right? But there is a problem. Too much integration can become an issue. For example, to maintain the speed of 60, you want the controller to output 0.7 so that you can counter the drag force at a speed of 60. But if integrator output has already become 0.8, then it means you have pressed the pedal more than required. So, speed will increase above 60, and this is called overshoot in control system terms. Now, the error between reference and feedback is negative, so integrator output will start reducing and it will eventually settle at 0.7, which is required to maintain the speed of 60. Luckily, we have a way to reduce this overshoot. This is where the differentiator comes into the picture. As the speeds are rising, the error is reducing, and hence the derivative of the error will be negative. If the error is reducing very fast, the derivative will be even more negative. So the derivative will do the job of reducing the controller output so that when the steady state is achieved, the overall output of the PID controller is 0.7. You will understand this better when we do an example. We will add the derivative term to our PID. What we can remember is, the proportional term will decide how fast the system is rising, the integral term will push the steady state error to 0, and the derivative term will attempt to reduce the overshoot. You should notice that both the proportional and the derivative term is 0 when the steady state is achieved. We also have the gains for the integral and derivative term, that is Ki and Kd, which helps us decide what is the contribution of each term. So, the task of tuning is to find the values of Kp, Ki and Kd. If they are not properly tuned, then the system can become unstable. Let us control the speed of the DC motor with whatever we learned. Over here, I have the model of the DC motor that I derived using linearization in the last video. I also have the original model using the first principles. We will tune the controller for the linearization model and we will then check if it works for the original system. The reference is a step input. Let us start with the proportional gain of 1. Here, we see that there is a large error. So we can increase the gain to, let us say, 10. Still, the error is more. Let us try out 40. Now, we see it is oscillating a lot. So, too high a value of Kp can lead to oscillations. Now, we will add the differentiator gain to reduce this overshoot. Again, I will try out some values. Let us start with 1 and run the simulation. Now, we have less overshoot. Let us try 3. I am okay with this overshoot. Finally, let us add the integral gain to reduce the steady state error. Again, let's start with 1. It did not provide any significant difference to the output. Let us increase it to 50. It's better, but I think we can still go further. Let us try 100. Much better. But we can even try 150. This looks good to me and I stick to these values. Let me also show you what happens when you keep Ki very high. Let us say 1500. It will start oscillating again. So, too much Kp or too much Ki will lead to oscillations. Too much Kd is also a problem due to noise in the system and we'll see that in the next video. Let's put Ki back to 150. So, we have tuned the controller. It is easy to do a hit and trial like this in the simulation. It is not good to do it on the actual hardware as it can damage it. And why should we use hit and trial when we have the control theory with us? Before we look at the method of loop shaping, we can actually just tune this PID controller automatically in MATLAB. We will double click on the PID block and click the tune button. In this auto tuner, we can just decide how robust the system needs to be and how fast do you want it to be. And we can update our controller if we are happy with this response. This was super easy and the values are very close to what we tuned earlier. We will also check whether this controller works with the original system. Yes, the output is following the reference well. So, we understood the art of PID tuning and also the auto-tuning method. Now, let us go to the science of PID tuning. There are a lot of methods to tune PIDs, but I'll be talking about the loop shaping technique we discussed in the previous video. I will not be teaching loop shaping over here as I have already explained it in the last few videos. Here we will see loop shaping in action. I have added a controller with a gain of 1 and I'll name it controller. Now, I'll go to the control systems toolbox, add this controller, and then open the Bode editor. You can see that we already have two poles in the system. MATLAB is smart enough to detect the loop gain of the system we want to control, and that is exactly what is plotted over here. These two poles are the poles of the DC motor. Our controller was 1 and hence it does not have any 0 or pole till now. We can clearly see that DC gain is too low, around minus 12 dB, and the steady state error will be large. So, let us add gain to the system by just dragging this plot upwards. We would like to have a very high 0 frequency gain and we can add an integrator for it. The transfer function for the integrator is 1 by s, and so at 0 radians per second, you get infinite gain. So, an integrator provides infinite DC gain. All you have to do is right-click and add an integrator. But how fast will this integrator reduce the steady-state error? That is decided by the crossover frequency of the loop gain. Let us say that our desired bandwidth is 5 radians per second. We will adjust the plot again so that we are near to 5 radians per second crossover frequency. But now, we have a problem. The phase margin is only 13.2 degrees and we will have an oscillatory response. For a PID control, we overcome the oscillation using a differentiator. But over here, let us add something called a lead compensator. It behaves just like a differentiator. We will see how. A lead compensator has one pole and one zero. The zero is more dominant than the pole. What that means is, the zero will lie closer to the origin. So, how does this compensator help? Let us take out its Bode plot. Here, we can see that there is a positive phase bump. And this is exactly what we need to increase the phase margin. So, if we can place this additional phase exactly at the crossover frequency, then we'll get a good phase margin. But you must also notice the gain is affected. So, crossover frequency is going to change and we might not get the full benefit of lead compensator. I'm not going into the mathematics of this, but let us see it in action so you get a better understanding of it. I'll again right click and add the lead compensator. Now I'll point to 5 radians per second as this is where we want the additional phase. Done. But a phase margin is still very less. We got a very small improvement. That is because the crossover frequency got shifted. We can just move this pole further down and bring down the gain of the system so that the crossover frequency is back to 5 radians per second. Great, you have achieved a very good phase margin now. I think this is a good open loop response for the system and we have tuned our controller. We can right click and click on edit compensator. This is the overall compensator of the controller transfer function. We have our gain, the integrator and the lead compensator. Remember our initial controller was set to 1. Now we can click on update block and check that it has indeed got updated. We can run the simulation and we have a nice step response. But you might be wondering, why did I add a lead compensator when we wanted to design a PID controller? Well, it does not matter much in the end when you have to discretize your controller. We'll see that in a later video. A lead compensator is very similar to a differentiator and I'll point it out again in the next video. What we designed today is a lead compensator with an integrator and a gain. It's much more intuitive to design a lead compensator while using the loop shaping technique. At the end, there is not much difference. For the next video, we'll see two issues with PID controller, integrator windup and differential noise, and how to tackle them. See you next time.